Hi, I'm Fred Sokolow, and this is Guitar Lesson on Jazz Chord Solos for Beginners. Jazz is probably the most harmonically sophisticated and complicated music we've got among all the different American genres of music like blues and country and rock and pop and so on, because it has a lot of chords and sophisticated harmonies. But you know what? You can play a lot of those chords right down here in the first position. They don't have to be crazy knuckle-twisting chords. They can be fairly simple first position chords. So I'm going to try to show you a bunch of arrangements of beautiful standard jazz tunes and use fairly simple changes to do them. When we say chord soloing, we mean playing a song where you're playing the chords and the melody at the same time. And that's what we'll do. In playing jazz standards, usually what you do on the guitar is you try to place the melody on the higher strings, on the first string and the second string as much as possible. And then you can harmonize the melody notes with the rest of the chord. So let's start by tuning up. Here's the low E string, the sixth string. And the fifth string A. Here's the fourth string D. The third string G. Second string B. And the first string E, the high E. We're going to start with a song called Autumn Leaves that's been done, it's been a hit many times over. It was written in the 40s in France with French lyrics, but Johnny Mercer later added English lyrics to it. It's, Edith Piaf sang it in France, and Nat Cole had a big hit with it. There's a Cannonball Adderley version of it with Miles Davis playing on it that's real famous. And there's still more real, Chet Baker sang it, and it's one of his signature tunes, too. So here's Autumn Leaves. The falling leaves drift by my window. Those autumn leaves of red and gold. I see your lips, those summer kisses. Sunburned hands I used to hold. Since you've gone away, the days grow long, and soon we'll hear old winter's song. But I miss you most of all, my darling, when autumn leaves begin to fall. Okay, this tune is in the key of A minor, and you know, A minor is the relative minor of C, so you expect to see C, F, and G. Those are the three chords for the key of C, right? And you expect to see A minor and D minor and E seventh. Those are the chords you get when you're in the key of A minor. You're kind of in two keys at once when you're in a minor key, the minor key and its relative major. So let's take a look at the left hand and look at all the chords involved in this tune. You notice I never did get up past the fifth fret, but there were still a lot of varieties of different types of chords. Starting on the A minor, it went to this D minor seventh, which is just two fingers, right? This and this, to a G. Sometimes when I play this G, I'll add this note because that makes it into a G seventh. If you're not playing this first string, you can't hear the G seventh otherwise. So, and then it goes to a C major seventh. That's the C major seventh is the chord you get when you open up the second string on the C chord, and then to the F major seventh, which is an F with the first string open. And then went to this chord here. We're going to call this a B minor 7 flat 5. You could also call it a B half diminished for short. And it looks like the diminished chord if you've ever played this chord shape, but up in the middle strings. And then from there to an E. And I had to reach over it for a melody note, but then, so then you're back to the A minor. Then it just repeats that sequence. Repeats it exactly. Then there's a sort of a little bridge section that goes to the E seventh, back to the A minor, then this D minor, not the D minor seventh, but the regular plain old D minor, and then a G seventh, C major seventh. Then we have another, you know, this half diminished chord we played, we have a variation of it. Looks like this. So we've got the fifth and the third string here, second string, first string. We're playing that variation because we're going to need this melody note later on. And then that goes to E seventh, to A minor, to D seventh, and then the other half diminished chord to E seventh and back to A minor. So, and throughout I kept lifting this thing up off the A minor just to get a nice little effect. When you're playing the melody of the song, let's look at that, what happens with the left hand when you're playing the melody. Because it's the same chords we just played, but there'll be slight variations just to incorporate the melody into the tune. So the melody is... So you had to reach up there for that melody note. And then that repeats. A little different. That's the E. D minor to the G. C major seventh, F major seventh, and here's that variation of the half diminished chord to E seventh, and you reach down for this melody note. Let's talk about what the right hand is doing in all this. It's kind of a free-for-all with the right hand, but in general, what's happening is you're strumming chords and ending the chord with the highest note, the melody note. Like, for example, you play the melody, and then the first string is the melody note, so I just strum the D minor 7th chord and play the highest note. And again, the highest note is the... Now, you can go and use your fingers as well. Here I'm playing the half diminished chord, but the second string is the melody note, so I don't strum past the second string. We want the first string to be the highest note, and that's going to be the rule throughout. Now if we end on a chord and play the melody note and there's still a little space rhythmically before the next melody note, there's all kinds of, you can strum on the chord like that, or you can do arpeggios where you just go up and down, up or down, or both, you know, if you have that much time, the strings of the chord, because you're not going to hit any wrong notes as long as you're in the playing the right chord. And that happens a lot in that happens a lot throughout the song, where you'll have a note that's sustained and there's just a big space there. If you didn't fill it with something, it would sound kind of empty. So we fill it with arpeggios or with strumming like this, and that pretty much tells the story of what I did on Autumn Leaves. I'm going to sing it and play it again, but this time with a split screen. I'll do it a little slower as well, so you can get a real close-up look at what's happening with both hands. The falling leaves drift by my window. Those autumn leaves of red and gold. I see your lips, the summer kisses, those sunburned hands I used to hold. Since you've gone away, the days grow long, and soon I'll hear old winter songs.